It's great to be here at the Googleplex. I just took some pictures and compared them to the pictures I took at the Alibaba Wetlands campus. The bicycles, there they have a Taobao alien, like your Android. So it feels oddly familiar here, but there's innovation happening in China too. So Jack, I think people have a pretty high level of understanding of obviously technology here and probably of China. So interrupt me if you'd like me to explain anything or if you want me to go deeper, probably going to be more the case. But Alibaba was founded in 1999. I've been living there, as Boris said, since 94. I went to China for 1 year in 94. I'm still there. So China has this habit of bringing you into the maelstrom. And the reason I went there for tech and telecom sort of infrastructure, because China didn't have it, right? This wouldn't have been possible in the mid-90s. There just wasn't anything. But the Chinese government oversaw, quite surprisingly, a big build-out of the internet and broadband technology and cellular technology, which they call xinxihua, or informatization. Everything is made in English. Everything is made in China today, including English words. Informatization describes the Chinese government's desire to basically, you know, wire up the country. And so Jack actually, Alibaba was his third venture. His first venture was a translation business. And his second business was actually an internet business, which he founded after visiting Seattle in 1995. I'm going to Seattle tonight, and I've actually retraced his steps there. That failed, so third time lucky with Alibaba. But before I get into that, just to give an overview of what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to take as many questions as possible. There are three key areas that I want to talk about. First is, what is the machinery really behind Alibaba? Why is it such a dominant company today in China's e-commerce sector and increasingly in other sectors? The second is, who is the man behind Alibaba? Because I actually set out writing a book about Alibaba, but it's a biography, ultimately, because Jack's imprints, thumbprints, are so all over the company culture, of course, which is to be expected. And the third is really the meaning of Alibaba, and why does it matter, including for us here, obviously here in Silicon Valley, but also here, the West, here, the world, because Alibaba is increasingly impacting countries, economies far beyond its shores. So in terms of the machinery, I'm not going to use any words, but it's just helpful to think about, this is actually an impossible construct, as you know, but Jack describes the reason Alibaba has been successful as the iron triangle, and that's really the iron triangle of e-commerce, finance, and logistics. These three things really create this defensible position, I should say, unassailable position so far. Alibaba has competitors in JD. Many of you know Tencent and WeChat, and WeChat is increasingly becoming a place for commerce as well. We have Weixin, but we also have Weidian. People are using WeChat to buy and sell things, but it's still much smaller. And by the way, Tencent and JD are actually related, so its main competitors are kind of a cluster. But in the first angle of this triangle, we have basically, or the first length, e-commerce. The two major sites that you know are not the company's first site. So Alibaba.com is a bit confusing for people in the US because they hear about Alibaba, they go on Alibaba.com, and it's a B2B site. It's often bulk, you know, you're buying 100,000 somethings, and you can buy smaller stuff, but generally it's the original business-to-business website that he started with. But the two key parts of this first side of the triangle are Taobao and Tmall. So Taobao is how basically Alibaba defeated eBay, and Tmall is more of its more recent site, which is where brands can sell directly to customers. And Taobao, though, is still, it's like, imagine just this scrappy street market online. That's basically what Alibaba has been successful in, is not charging merchants to sell. And eBay, you know, was always saying free is not a business model, because eBay used to charge, and it was too late. So I have a whole chapter on it's kind of like the Hurricane Katrina, you know, heck of a job kind of eBay disaster in China. And, you know, eBay, to their credit, was quite early. Meg Whitman had an early sort of passion for China based on some family connections that I reveal, but kind of messed up the advantage that they had with HNet, which was an acquisition that they made. So that's the first side. The second side really is finance, so Alipay today. I mean, I don't think, yeah, you had a payment for here with Apple Pay and other forms of payment on Google, but of course, in China, really, Alipay is the digital currency for many, many things. I mean, Tencent also has TenPay, and on WeChat, people are increasingly using that. But critically, you can still like gift money for people on Alipay without a fee. I mean, you can actually pay for any number of products or services. Increasingly, people do leave their wallet at home in China. So Alipay, it's not just the financial kind of capability, it's the data. Of course, it's the understanding of what consumers are using or what they're intending to purchase. And you know, Alibaba has become this disruptive force in the Chinese financial services industry. It has this product called Yuebao, which is leftover treasure, because Taobao is like a treasure chest. So the Bao, the idea is that people had this money sitting in their accounts, this Alipay accounts, and Jack said, well, why don't we just launch a money market fund? We'll give you 2% higher rates of interest than the banks. And within 6 months, it was $100 billion, US dollars, funds had gone into that account and became, I think, the second largest money market fund in the world, you know, overnight, pretty much. Because Chinese banks are products of the state. You know, there some of them are better, like China Merchants Bank, and the banks now are trying to respond. But Jack realized the same opportunity that he found in e-commerce, which is basically giving people choice for the first time. He's doing that in finance as well. Because people understand that, back to the first edge, e-commerce, Jack likes to say that in the US, e-commerce is dessert, but in China, it's the main course, because offline retail was never very efficient. And so the impact of online or e-commerce and also m-commerce have been so disruptive because people, for the first time, can actually order comfortably and confidently and return things. And all this customer service that really is becoming, has come through the internet. And the same is true in the second triangle side of payment. And the third side is logistics. So, you know, it's fine to have a wide variety of choice of products and the ability to pay with escrow so you don't get ripped off. But if the goods don't show up or they're damaged, then, you know, it's useless. So actually, there's been a massive growth in China's courier market. And interestingly, three of the four largest courier companies in China are based in a town called Tonglu, which is, I think, about 100 kilometers from Hangzhou. Imagine if FedEx and UPS and name one other were all from the same village, effectively in, I don't know, Nashville or something. And actually quite interrelated. Some of the founders of these companies are related to each other. And these companies grew up because of Alibaba and other Zhejiang kind of providers. So I wanted to talk a little bit about Zhejiang. You can't really see this, but Zhejiang is a province that's kind of hard for people to pronounce. I mean, Westerners, you know. People might know Hangzhou, but they should also know Wenzhou and Yiwu, you know, and Ningbo and many others, and Tonglu I just mentioned. It's the thriving entrepreneurial soup at the heart of China's economic revolution. Anybody here from Zhejiang? Oh, okay. So, see, they can't leave. It's so good. People can't even leave Zhejiang. And I think what's important about this is it's a place that has always had a very high appetite for risk because it was somewhat overlooked. It has traditions, if you go back centuries, of being a very prosperous place. Hangzhou itself, you know, is the southern end of the what we call the Grand Canal in English. You know, Hangzhou is, in Chinese, you call it the Beijing Hangzhou Grand Canal. So Hangzhou has always been a wealthy trading center. It was the largest city in the world in the 13th century. People like Ibn Battuta visited, and or allegedly Marco Polo. But anyway, so you've had the Hangzhou thing, but you've had all these other towns where people have been making things, trading things. And so this was really Jack's constituency. So he's not a tech guy. He failed in math many times. He's not an engineer, but he's been an entrepreneur. He's been an entrepreneur's entrepreneur, really, since the beginning. He understands this place. He grew up on the streets, really, of Hangzhou. He actually was selling plastic carpets to supplement his income as an English teacher and in his first venture. So he's done the hustle. He was going down to the Guangzhou Fair, the Canton Fair. He was visiting Wenzhou, places like that. And this has become a center. Wenzhou, actually, this is sort of coins here. But this is where we've had street lending, curbside lending, gray market lending. It's all coming out of Zhejiang. So I think one thing I hope to achieve in the book is that read this chapter on the Zhejiang experience and how does it affect us. I like to say the seats that we're sitting on, the lights that are shining on us, this podium, probably if it's within the last 10 years, which I think it has been here, was either made or traded somehow in Zhejiang. At some point it passed through, particularly the city of like Yiwu, which now has its own international airport. Anyway, it's like the new kind of caravanserai, kind of Silk Road kind of feeling of trade in China. And toothbrushes, so when the first entrepreneurs in Wenzhou, there was a meeting the Chinese government, the local government summoned some entrepreneurs, I think it was 81, 82, and they actually all arrested for being speculators, because of course, it wasn't clear in the early 80s that you could actually make money. I put this here because when I visited Alibaba in 99, I got to know Jack when they just founded the company and they were 18 co-founders. And literally I went, I was using the restroom and there were these mugs of toothbrushes kind of stuffed in there, indicating they were working 24/7. The point about toothbrushes is that these entrepreneurs, when they were arrested, they were still in prison when another group of entrepreneurs back in 81 were summoned to the government. And of course they thought they were gonna be arrested. So they all took toothbrushes with them and put them in their pockets. So the toothbrush became the symbol of, well, we're gonna try and make some money, but we may get arrested. So, you know, Jack Ma, we'll talk about later, has links, and obviously has to deal with the Chinese government. And people sometimes in the West say, well, how can you work with the government? Well, you can't not work with the government in China. And it's not just because you want to curry favor or have subsidy. But this symbol of the toothbrush, and by the way, all the world's toothbrushes pretty much are made in, I think, one town in southern Jiangsu or northern Zhejiang. I mean, this, they're all from there anyway. So you could go through your home, actually, and figure out where everything's from, and a lot of it will be from there. So Jack had chutzpah, but he also had some luck, in a sense. This is Jack, and this picture I found through this gentleman on the left, who's my age. I'm 47. Here he is, 12 years old, a guy called David Morley. And this picture hadn't really been seen, and the family shared it for the first time in the book. This is Jack Ma at 15, Ma Yun, as he was then known. He started to call himself Jack. And this is on the shores of the West Lake in Hangzhou. And Jack used to go up to, he's told the story many times, but I'm trying to make it a bit more personal because this meeting changed his life, literally. He approached this kid, David Morley, who today runs a yoga studio in New South Wales, in Newcastle, New South Wales. I tracked him down. I was calling up random David Morleys. And this guy was like, g'day, how can I help? And basically, they became pen pals. So they became pen pals, and David's father, Ken Morley, who was a socialist, his mother was a communist, he was a member of the Australian Communist Party. The family had gone, this is in 1980, so they had gone to Hangzhou with their kids, three kids, to show them the workers' paradise, because they also went to Cuba. but David was flicking matches in the park, literally flaming matches, trying flicking them with a friend, almost burnt down the forest. But Jack, because of that spark, I like to say a spark can start a prairie fire. Of course, Mao said that. But in the case of Ma, this match drew his attention. He went up to David, started talking. They became pen pals. Later on, Jack ended up going to Australia. And the Morley family, it was just for a month, but the Morley family actually bought him an apartment and supported him. And so he had the means, actually, to start his first venture. So it's interesting, like fate. You know, how does this work? Now, fast forward to Jack, his first venture, which is a translation business. He had the second business, which is called China Pages, which was after Seattle. He realized we can get online and sell stuff. We can help China connect to the world, because it was nothing. China wasn't on. This is in 95. And so he started this China Pages business. But the local telecom company, Zhejiang Telecom, thought that was a great idea. So they started China Page, singular. So Jack's China Pages, and then the government, China Page, let's talk. So ultimately, he lost his second business, ultimately. And again, he'd been an English teacher. Having learned English from the Morleys and others, he became squeaked into college, became an English teacher. And ultimately, it was a tour guide. So after he lost China Pages, he worked for MOFTEC, the Ministry of Foreign Trade and Economic Cooperation, and which no longer exists. It's down MOFCOM, effectively. But he was tapped one day to be a tour guide for this guy called Jerry Yang, who was visiting China. This was Jerry's first visit. He came with his brother and a friend of mine here. So these pictures actually haven't been seen before. You've seen this picture. Interestingly, I don't know why, but this is Jack's wife, Kathy. But somehow it got cropped. And so one of the great stories about Alibaba is women. They're a third of the co-founders, 6 out of 18 are women. Kathy ran their international business when I was working. I was hired as a consultant to them in the early days. So, and also Lucy Peng, who runs the Alipay Ant Financial business that I mentioned earlier. By the way, today the story is saying it's worth $60 billion, just that business. So women play a very integral role in this. But this chance meeting, because literally he was a tour guide to Jerry, because he spoke such good English, going back to meeting David, chance, luck. Fast forward from, this is 97, I believe, to 2005, and Jerry Yang, of course, invested, Yahoo invested $1 billion in Alibaba, and then really kind of got rid of eBay's ambitions in the country. And as you know, that has been the single most profitable investment of any Silicon Valley company in China. There's a better investment in Tencent, but it's not a Silicon Valley company. So Tencent the South African company Naspers, MIH, this Africana sort of media company that was sort of dealing with the transition and internationalizing, invested in Tencent. And their $40 million investment today is worth, I think, $70 billion. But anyway, the $1 billion that went into Alibaba transformed Yahoo. And today we're still talking about, like, what is the value of Yahoo beyond this? And of course, the Japan asset with SoftBank. And SoftBank is an interesting connection also, because there's also what I call a golden triangle relationship. We have the iron triangle of e-commerce, logistics, and payment. We have a golden triangle really between Jerry Yang, Jack Ma, and not shown here, Masayoshi Son. Because Masa, as you know, famously backed Yahoo very early on. And he also backed Jack Alibaba very early on. So interesting kind of the fate of these the companies are increasingly intertwined. And then this is, so he founded Alibaba. The one thing about Alibaba is it's always been a lot of people. You know, Jack had, I said 17 other people that co-founded. Mostly are shown here. This is his wife. This is Lucy Pong, I mentioned. And some of these people had already worked with him for years. I mean, some of them actually followed him from this translation business. They moved. They were in the China Pages business. They even worked with him in the government when he had to go to Beijing. And when I met him in the summer of 99. And by January 2000, we were both speaking at Harvard Business School. And I remember walking down the frozen banks of the Charles River, and there was a camera like filming our every move. And I said, is this your? And I learned that this classmate had been filming him for years. So Jack had this great sense of confidence. I like that joke when you have your class picture when you're all lined up like this. If somebody holds a hula hoop around them, like, it'll save the biographer in 20 years. You know, like, this is me. You know, that supreme level of confidence. So Jack has that. I describe it as kind of chutzpah and blarney, because he's got this gift of the gab, and he's got this incredible ability to motivate people and take risks. So this is the apartment where I met him. And they still have this apartment, actually. You can visit it. And this is where they incubated Taobao. So the first business was this Alibaba.com. But when they came around to taking on eBay, Jack sent a team. You know, it's like the Google garage. I mean, it's the same kind of legend that we all have. And he said, don't come out until you come out with this business. Luckily, in a way, horribly for China, but SARS happened, so these people couldn't leave anyway, so they came out with a great product. So today, I mean, what does this matter? And we'll take some questions very quickly. I just put here, provocatively, a map of the west coast of the United States with the names in Chinese, of Seattle and Guigu and all this stuff, because this is how Alibaba set up. They set up, have an office in New Montgomery Street in San Francisco. They're now in San Mateo. You probably drive by that. It's kind of red, orange building, San Mateo. They've set up in Pasadena, which if you talk to people in Hollywood, it's like, what are they doing in Pasadena? Because everybody's on the west side. You know, the best Chinese food, of course, is like Alhambra, San Gabriel. So, you know, I'm thinking they're like revolutionizing Hollywood. And then in Seattle, where I'm going tonight, they have a team there. Of course, Amazon is something they look at and measure themselves by. Alibaba hates to be described as the Amazon of China because they don't carry inventory and they're actually scaling much faster in many ways. But inevitably, people make those comparisons. And there are some similarities, I think, between Jeff Bezos and Jack, not in terms of their background, but their commitment to customer first. Jack's mantra is customer first, employee second, shareholders third. And that's why he does things for free. Just like Amazon is constantly investing and, you know, they've been loss-making for many years. Anyway, so this matters to the US because, well, here we are in Silicon Valley. They're going to be hiring talent. When I'm no longer a visiting scholar at Stanford, but when I was there a few years ago, we had, Jack came to speak twice, first in English, and then he came back in Chinese to recruit talent because he wants people to come back. And remember I said, anybody here from Zhejiang? Maybe they all went back to work for Alibaba, I don't know. But it's a tremendous talent pool here. Silicon Valley, as you know, is a talent pool for the world, including a lot of Indian and Chinese talent. So Jack's been doing that. So that's a narrow impact, but also the scale of Alibaba is so big that their fight domestically with Tencent and Baidu, what we call the BAT, increasingly is having international consequences. So, for example, Baidu is hooked up with Uber, so Alibaba and Tencent are both investing in Lyft, you know, and so we're seeing kind of a three-dimensional global chessboard now. But consumers don't really know this very much. Like Alibaba sites here in the US, it's not that relevant. People know the IPO, so they went public in 2014 and raised $25 billion. It's still the largest IPO in history. But where we are seeing the bigger impact actually is in emerging markets. So this book in English is now, it's coming out in Chinese in mainland and Taiwan, but just as an indicator, it's also in Brazil, it's coming in Spain, it's in Russia, it's Ukraine, Indonesia, because these are places that really use Alibaba's websites. So AliExpress, which is sort of the international version, is the number one website, for example, in Russia. And all Alibaba did was just translate some of the names of the products. And they actually crashed the Russian postal service. Because, you know, as we know, Russia doesn't make anything. The Russians make great companies, Sergey. But Russia is famously not actually producing stuff. So the China connection for those countries is very important. But what's different now, Alibaba is also setting up offices in New York and Washington, Milan, Munich, Paris, London. They want to get closer to Western brands who want to sell into China. Jack says, we don't need to help Chinese sell here anymore. I mean, Chinese will do that anyway. But Chinese, the emerging Chinese consumer classes, want to buy more authentic things, higher value. And so this is the big opportunity. He wants to recruit brands. And there's issues about fakes that they're trying to address. And let's take some questions. I don't want to go on much longer. Do we have a mic or? And if I speak too fast, you can, you know, there's an app where we can slow it down. There's a lot to get through with Alibaba, sorry. You have questions back there? Yeah, I can repeat it if it's easier. Oh, he's gonna do this because we have the video as well on YouTube.
Hello.
Got some other things to talk about. Yeah.
Hello. Is it working now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Specifically, what did you do when you consulted for Alibaba?
Oh yes. So I met him, as I mentioned, in the summer of 99, and they were just getting going. It was a B2B website, so their weakness was they had coders and all that, but they didn't really have much connection with the outside world. So I helped them set up their first European office and helped them with some of their early PR, although I'm not a PR guy, and I helped them hire people. Because the first investor in Alibaba, it turned out, was my former classmate from Morgan Stanley. So I was at Morgan Stanley, she moved to Goldman. They did actually raise money in September of 99, and Joe Tsai, the vice chair, was a very important person in the company, moved to the company. So they were different from other startups. They had a pretty significant investor, and they had some talent, but they really didn't know like the West in terms of how to deal with like chambers of commerce and trade associations. So I helped them on that. But within a few months, I mean, the dot-com bust happened, you know, in the spring summer of 2000. So stupidly, I actually had the right to buy shares at 30 cents. I had to do by 2003 when it came. This is before eBay, before they took on eBay. And people were like, well, Jack's a great guy, but you know, the company, it's not that interesting. Business to business, there was no revenue much. I mean, you have to pay some listing fees. It was, so I didn't exercise those options. So my hope with this book is I'm gonna sell lots of copies because that cost me $30 million. So I've learned not to underestimate Jack. But then they did overexpand in those initial years. They cut back, famously B2C, back to China. They cut back, they refocused, they did the eBay thing, and then they grew ever since. So the company's had itself. The failures I mentioned earlier are not just before Jack started the company. It's within Alibaba's history. There's been lots of ups and downs. And so that creates a nice narrative. So yeah, so I was just a consultant. Yeah. I mean, there is this domestic competition. I would say one thing, that international strategy is often linked to their domestic competitive battle, like I mentioned with the Uber example, and so on. I mean, with Baidu. So there's generally the fault lines. Interestingly, like the personalities, I think Jack and Pony Ma, who run Tencent, actually they get on pretty well. I mean, they respect each other, but the businesses are increasingly competitive. But Baidu is often seen as a, you know, that they don't get on with, Baidu has actually been slipping in terms of the BAT. Right, these companies are much bigger. So anyway, I think that they will that'll often feed into their mentalities. Not just in the case of the Uber style thing. That there've been several investments where Alibaba and Tencent have teamed up, including some of the O2O stuff and the food stuff within China. So that's one thing. It's like, what is the international implications of partnering with a Google? But as you said, in China, Google, and we know is in China for different reasons, but not the mainstream China that it used to be. So maybe that's a good thing in a way. Google has more of a neutral position in terms of the Chinese market. You know, I mean, just this last week, Alibaba invested $1 billion into Southeast Asia, one of the rocket kind of clone things, is a sign that they want to kind of leverage, I mean, Chinese goods that, you know, if you go to Singapore, for example, people build their whole apartments, they design it, you know, using Tmall and Taobao. There's a natural affinity in terms of commerce and now even culture with Southeast Asia and China. So, you know, they'll be looking to play those types of relationships. So specific to Google, I mean, in other parts of the world, I'm not sure yet. I'm trying to think of any specific examples where they've partnered. Within China, Amazon is actually on Alibaba. So Amazon operates a store on Tmall because they have about 2% of the Chinese market. So that's an example of, well, you know, we might as well, if you can't beat them, join them. But internationally, I don't know. I was speaking with Reid Hoffman the other day, and he's always had this vision. He's been very early on China in its impact. And years ago, actually, I spoke to him. He said, there's going to be the Chinese-dominated internet world. Of course, there's the U.S.-dominated internet countries, which is the U.S., but also Europe, where you're very strong, for example. And then there's other. So this is the interesting thing. Like, what's going to be happening in Africa, in other parts of Asia, and South America? I mean, Baidu's tried to launch a Portuguese service in Brazil, and Xi Jinping came there, but I think it's kind of tokenistic. I don't think that's real. I think what's interesting about commerce is that it spreads more easily, and it plays to Alibaba's advantages. Whereas you get into content, I mean, even, you know, Jack could try and buy Yahoo to get back the stake, but then people would immediately be, oh, you know, information, China. So I think commerce is a natural play. So in a sense, and actually what I didn't talk about is in Hollywood. So actually just yesterday, Alibaba announced they're going to be partnering or investing in some new Paramount titles, including Star Trek and Ninja Turtles. And last year, working with Tom Cruise and the whole Mission Impossible franchise. And so Americans are beginning to get this, you know, within the first 2 seconds of a movie, it's Alibaba Pictures. I'm like, who the hell's that? I think content, increasingly you'll see international investments, we are. And not just them, there's other companies like Wanda, which bought AMC Theaters, bought Legendary Entertainment. So you have to look, and I have a chapter on the Zhejiang stuff is important because some of these entrepreneurs are all from Zhejiang, like the guy from Fosun who bought Club Med. And these Zhejiang guys, sometimes they co-invest, actually. It's a different kind of capitalism. It's very collaborative capitalism in a way. So maybe that's going to inform the way that they partner internationally. So I understand this Zhejiang. I call it the Billionaires Boys Club. Jack has a fund called Yunfeng. And this is how sometimes he'll invest personally. Sometimes the company will invest. He's doing crazy stuff. He just bought a chateau in France, the Chateau de Source. And he declared September 9th will be wine tasting day in China, Jiuzhou. Jiuzhou like alcohol, the 99. So suddenly, like, wine sales are going through. So you can't really predict what he's up to from one day to the next. And so I think Jack is, you know, one of the most difficult people to meet now. He's very approachable when you meet him, but he's surrounded by so many people, you know, because he could make these crazy decisions. He's bought a football team, he admitted, when he was drunk. The Guangzhou Evergrande football team, the guy said, yeah, I got him drunk, and he bought it. So maybe that wine thing might not work out for him. But so... This is a picture of Jack and Xi Jinping in, I believe, 2006. So Xi Jinping had actually been party secretary of Zhejiang province. But actually, from my understanding, they didn't actually meet, or there wasn't a formal meeting then. And we know Xi Jinping is obviously centralizing a lot of power. He's, you know, kind of dispensing with some of the collegiate style management. And so it's very important, you know, how is Jack's relationship with Xi Jinping? This is when Xi Jinping was the party secretary of Shanghai, which he was briefly after Zhejiang. So they have connection. Jack meets a lot more with the prime minister, who nobody can remember, Li Keqiang, because actually Xi Jinping has concentrated so much power that most of the ministers and prime ministers, you know, around him are devalued. So Jack has always said, you know, fall in love with the government, but don't marry them. And you know, just respect the government. What does that mean? Well, in the book, I say if he did marry the Chinese government, he'd be a polygamist because it would be Alibaba and the 40 wives, right? There are so many arms of the Chinese government. And Jack actually talks about this. He's talked privately about this, which I heard about, saying that last year there were 40,000 visits from Chinese government officials to Alibaba. Can you imagine? I mean, Google, today, who's here? I mean, it must be the president of some three countries and a prime minister. I mean, you get that. You get that in China too. I mean, when I was meeting him, there was like the, you know, the king of Sweden and the president of Ireland, you know, at Alibaba. But they also get the government officials from every level quite very often. So the point is, as he's getting into things like finance and particularly media, you know, how does he avoid stepping on toes? And he's bought the South China Morning Post in Hong Kong recently. Some say, well, that's a politically inspired move because he's helping the Chinese government with a problem in Hong Kong. You know, Hong Kong is very divided right now. There's a lot of social problems and political tension. You know, it is a strange move because Jeff Bezos bought the Washington Post, and they just won a Pulitzer yesterday. So he's been very hands-off. You know, it's more of a personal thing. So you could have said Jack would have done that personally, but it's the company of Alibaba, and they're talking about how they get more involved with communicating China to the world. So there's a political element to that. So my answer to your question is his relation with the government is like a dance, or dance, if I'm in England. But he has no choice not to do it because he has to do this because he has to create the space for his ambitions. He wants to go beyond e-commerce into finance, into media, and other things, healthcare, for example. So he has to have at least the nod from the government, and he really wants to help the government deal with their problems. And the biggest problem today in China is the shift away from the old China model of manufacturing, exports, pollution. I mean, there was a horrible case, I don't know if you saw, just over the weekend in, I think, southern or in Jiangsu province, where the school was built on a disused chemical site. And within 4 or 5 months, I mean, 80% of the students had this horrible injury. You know, so Jack's become an environmentalist. So the government knows, I mean, frankly, the Communist Party, to stay in power, has to deliver the economic growth and the benefits, create the middle class. So I think Alibaba is like a bright and shiny object that the government can point to, because it has actually changed people's lives, not just as consumers, because it's given them trust and choice. But also, you know, 9 million people operate stores on Taobao. I mean, some of them are merchants, you know, companies, but a lot of them are individuals, you know. And so people are supplementing their income, or it is their entire income, selling stuff online. That's helpful in a restructuring away from the old types of coal mining, steel of the past. But the last chapter, by the way, is called Icon or Icarus, because he's an icon, but he could be flying too close to the sun. And he admits this himself. But I like to joke, if you needed a pair of wax and feather wings, you could probably find it on Taobao. So he can always create his own parachute or something. It's a mixed metaphors.
Hey, Duncan. I'm going to use the microphone. Can you talk a little bit about what do you think his strategy might be for the next 10, 20 years? Like, you know, the long-term vision?
Yeah, he talks about the 10-year vision. The great thing about 10 years is, you know, it's long enough that people can't really remember or disprove you. But so his kind of hokey description of this is the 2H strategy. So health and happiness. So healthcare, I mentioned, well, some of these pollution problems are creating massive issues. The one-child policy and the skewing of the gender ratios and all that is creating a lot of issues of rapidly aging population and, people's diet, too much smoking. So there's a time bomb right now in China with health. And Jack talks about this. People around him have been affected by this. It is something objective that you do hear a lot about. So he's bought a pharmaceutical company. He wants to get more heavily into the healthcare sector. China has amazing doctors. I mean, some of the best doctors in the world, because they treat more people in a day than, you know, a doctor here would in like a year. The problem is getting to them. So one thing Alibaba did actually was offer online bookings for doctors in Beijing. And actually, the government told them to stop. It was revealing the massive inefficiency and also the scalpers and make a lot of money. So, you know, clearly healthcare is one thing. We could also talk about education, you know, massive need for reform. The other H, though, he talks about is happiness. So healthcare and happiness. Happiness for him is describing, you know, content. So it's why he's investing in Hollywood, because he wants to have heroes who don't die in the movies. Because he says, you know, in Hollywood, that all the heroes live. In China, they die. And so he wants to shift to more of that sort of more optimistic thing, which is kind of, again, useful to the government, sort of like uplifting people during these transitions. So that's why he's investing not only in Hollywood, but he's also investing heavily in China, of course, and bringing in content as well as creating original content. I think they have their first feature-length film called Baidu, not the same Baidu as its competitor. Baidu Rin, I think, is coming out this year. So he's hired some of the top directors. So, you know, he's got aspirations not just in film, but in television. TBO is the Tmall box office. Sounds familiar. It's like a Netflix-style play. So it's really shifting from products to services and content. But the other big thing I should mention is, particularly for you guys, is the shift from what he calls IT to DT, from the information technology world to the data technology world. And what he means by that is, of course, all this information flowing through that iron triangle and the cloud, of course, Ali Cloud, you know, it's predicting behavior. For example, they bought, I think, the largest ticketing service for movie tickets. So they start to get the habits of who's buying, where they are. And the idea is to start saying, well, we know these people like this, so we're going to talk to the director to make that for them. And this might even start having international consequences. You've already seen how movies, sometimes now the Chinese are not the villains, well, they're no longer the villains, and often they're the heroes. It started with the movie 2012. Actually, I was talking at the Asia Society last week in New York, and I used this example. I didn't realize the former head of the Asia Society, his son, I forget his first name, Platt, anyway, he's like the evil guy in 2012, the evil Westerner. And then the Chinese saved the world by building the ships to the Noah's Ark, you know. And I remember watching that movie in Beijing with some Chinese friends, and they were like, what the hell's going on? Like, we're the heroes? That's not, you know, and when was the last time you saw like a Chinese villain? I mean, North Korea still plays a great role in that. So I think it's that idea of like, in a sense, not only is Jack trying to create the capacity within China for his ambitions, but even the, in the world. I mean, the soft power that Jack has, you know, in a sense, having that picture of him earlier with Xi and Jack is interesting. In APEC in November in Manila, President Obama interviewed Jack. And to be fair, a Filipina entrepreneur, but it was a sense that Obama was kind of paying respect to this new entrepreneurial, you know, class of people coming up. And Xi Jinping was also at the APEC summit, but, you know, that the coverage he gets is very different, you know. So which of these Chinas is going to emerge? I think just in terms of the overall picture, we've had this rise of the East through Alibaba showing that they could take on, you know, eBay, they could bring in Yahoo's money, they could basically sit at the top table now for in the tech world, right? I mean, I think people wouldn't deny that. And I think the same for Tencent, even more, I think, in terms of innovation. But I think that West-East axis is one thing, and that's why Jack is famous in China. He's mobbed, he's a hero. But I'm more interested now in the North-South. You know, Beijing is still where political power is concentrated, and yet the economic wealth and innovation capacity of China really is in the South, or the East, if you say Southeast. So how long can this continue? Like, and the party, though, never underestimate their ability to be pragmatic, to shift, to change. So, you know, bringing these guys into the party, or at least bringing them to be at the service of the overall goal. And, you know, the consequences in China of them failing to do that is nothing that we should get excited about. Chaos in China. And this is a lot of Chinese people understand. It's like stability, growth is kind of essential. But the model is frayed right now. We've seen GDP dropping. We've seen FDI dropping. And this September, actually, China will host the G20 in Hangzhou. Inconvenient time because China's had lots of problems with the financial markets. It's had its currency. It's had the stock market. But in September, world leaders will converge on Hangzhou. And I think Jack will be a useful symbol. Of course, he's playing a leading role in that conference.
Questions?
They have food delivery services. Speaking of food.
But in terms of things like security, privacy, access to user data, stuff like that that we kind of take for granted here, you know, for Alibaba, what's the story? What's the track record in terms of policy?
Chinese don't take those things for granted in terms of the privacy and things. I mean, to be honest, I think.
So Jack Ma pretty much opens up the shop, lets them take a look around and see who's buying
what.
Oh,
well, no, I mean, so they do operate, you know, they have the cloud services. And so, of course, the story is that they're going to be building businesses to serve third parties, much like Amazon Web Services. Also, they're offering credit services, like Sesame Credit, the ability to analyze. But of course, they're not putting this out on the web, and they have a commercial incentive to manage data correctly. But they're coming from a very different cultural imprint, of course, because in China, people never really had that sense of privacy. It is emerging, though. I mean, we are seeing, you know, as the middle classes emerge, they become, you know, they have more things, and things include data and their identity. But
for anyone who's thinking of anyone close to being political opposition, anything that the government might not approve of?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of known in China. If you were to go to Tiananmen Square and unfurl a banner, that's one thing. But if you do the virtual equivalent, you're probably going to have the same consequences, right? And particularly recently, yeah, under Xi Jinping, including media has been definitely, you know, the public space is definitely kind of restricting. And Alibaba also bought, I should mention, they bought Youku, so your equivalent to YouTube, which was Youku Tudou, is now Alibaba. Also Weibo, which is China's equivalent to Twitter. And that has been hemmed in, you know, celebrities have stopped, including celebrity professors or intellectuals have stopped sharing, you know, these opinions. So some of them had 50 million followers or more, you know, and some of them were arrested. And, you know, so definitely the public space has been definitely constrained. WeChat, interestingly, you can have, I think, up to 100 people in your account. So people are kind of spreading information through circles. And that's kind of the new normal in China, is not to take a megaphone, but it's kind of, dare I say, Chinese whispers. But there is this, you know, people, like the great thing in China, people are amazingly aware of what's happening in the world in their own country. They're very, you know, creative. They're traveling the world. I mean, look at the flights that are coming here. I was at the launch of the Beijing-San Jose flight with Hainan Airlines, Bay Jose. And you know they're launching, Hainan is launching a Changsha, Los Angeles flight. So China's increasingly connected to the world, you know, and Chinese are. The big challenge is, can there be a political or social evolution to, you know, reflect this economic reality? And it's, nobody knows the answer to this. But you're right, it's a sensitive thing for them and for people in China. But there's a great awareness in China of where the line is. And the line is shifting right now. But the other big problem is, of course, the Great Firewall. And we should say that Alibaba has benefited to some degree from that, but more in terms of the financial services area. Like PayPal was never really given free rein to operate was Alipay was able to do things that perhaps PayPal couldn't do. But PayPal screwed up in China for other reasons. But if you talk, you know, if you're talking about YouTube used to exist in China, then it was blocked. Twitter used to exist and was blocked. So there's this endless debate, like, you know, of course companies like Baidu say, well, we would have always beat, you know, Google. We would have always, we'll never know, right? I mean, and actually Google was doing quite well when Google decided to leave. So I think China really has confidence in itself. I hate to say this, but the making China great again was a horrible phrase, has been used, but it's really getting back to its innovative capacity, right? I mean, we have, think of what came from China before, you know, the gunpowders and the compass and all these type of things. The idea is, when can China be a really confident member of the world? You know, increasingly Chinese are individually, right, within great companies like Google and whatever. But China is still kind of constrained, perhaps, by the wrapping of the party. And the way that we see China is through, you know, state media and the Western media, frankly, that covers the state media in that way. I mean, I think the great thing about China is just go yourself. You know, get a cheap flight from Los Angeles to Changsha, you know, and just go experience for yourself. Yeah, and that's, you know, it's a challenge though for China that, you know, not more figures like Jack. I mean, Jack is, I think, a bridge, you know, and maybe, look, let's not be naive. He might be a vessel we pour our aspirations into for how we want China to develop, but there's nothing wrong with that. We have to have hope. Jack's first company was called Hope.
So you mentioned that they have video recordings of Jack for many, many years,
yes.
And they are now investing in Hollywood.
Yeah. I mean, there is this documentary out there, but in terms of actually a full-length movie, I don't know. Like, who would make the movie? My guess is, my prediction is Jack will one day buy Paramount Pictures because Paramount made his most famous, his favorite movie, Forrest Gump. So Jack talks endlessly about Forrest Gump, and still today he talks about, we go after the shrimp, not the whales. And anyway, so I have this image of Jack sitting on that bench that Forrest Gump sat on, you know, and say, well, finally, this is mine. But maybe then that studio could make the movie. But I don't know who in Hollywood would want to make a movie about Jack, although they're welcome to talk to my agent. because, you know, you're dealing with, you know, it's still an evolving story, but also somebody who's very influential and has big ambitions and big investments are being made. So it's an interesting question. So far, I think he's decided he wants to keep like a low profile, and I mean, he's already so high. I think his wife was saying, "Oh no, we don't want to do that." So we'll see. Somebody did try, and then it didn't happen. So let's see. You know, I think a cartoon would be good because Jack's such an amazing character. I think it would be perfect. Well, again, I think their number one thing is they can sell their platform as a gateway to China for Western brands, because, you know, if you want to sell into China today, like Singles Day, I don't know if you know, November 11th. Alibaba created Singles Day, 1-1-1-1. There's more singles people than happy Valentine's Day people in China. So he created a holiday, effectively, for shopping. And this has become a huge attraction to Western brands who want to sell. I mean, last year they did $14 billion of sales on that day, which is like 3x Cyber Monday. So number one, people are going to be drawn to Alibaba as a gateway to the emerging Chinese middle class. So that gives them an international impact. That's why they have these offices in places like, you know, Munich and Milan, like close to the brand, some of whom have been suing them in the past over fakes, but others are saying, well, we're going to work with you to offer the real thing. So that they have an international impact already. And the same, I would say, for talent, what they're trying to, you know, raising capital, largest IPO. So the question is, what about them going internationally themselves? Well, they did have this 11 Main website, which you probably never heard of because they shut it. This was an attempt to introduce kind of the Alibaba experience to US consumers, but you don't actually need it because we have Target, we have Walmart, we have Amazon. So in a sense, some people think, oh, the Chinese are going to be like the Japanese wave. I mean, they come over, they buy the hotels, and they buy the Monets and the Van Goghs, and they lose their shirts. I don't see it that way. I think the Chinese entrepreneurs are more savvy. Some are stupid, frankly, and we've seen some crazy deals. I mean, we almost saw Anbang buying this, you know, not Marriott, but the whichever hotel chain, anyway. Massive overpaying, you know. But these entrepreneurs, particularly from Zhejiang, they're more savvy, you know. So I think they want to invest in Western companies, learn from them, maybe get some technology, but not necessarily, particularly in the U.S., like put up their brand here. Because, you know, frankly, in Washington, D.C., there are people who don't want them to succeed. Not them, Alibaba, but like Huawei, for example. Huawei makes great stuff, but, you know, they've been blocked from selling into like U.S. carriers, like Sprint. Masayoshi Son, who bought Sprint, wanted to buy equipment from Huawei for the U.S., but he was blocked. But in Europe, where I'm from, in U.K., like, Huawei's everywhere. So there's a sense that, you know, some people in Washington, still the reds under your bed, but I like to joke, well, the bed is made in China. You can sleep on the floor if you want, but I mean, China's part of whatever's happening today, the problems in the world, the solutions in the world. And so Alibaba has to kind of tread carefully, particularly into content. That's why I think commerce will be more. And content, though, Hollywood, they are investing because Hollywood's, you know, all about making money, right? And China's box office next year will probably be bigger than the US box office. And also we've got games like with Tencent and NetEase, some other great companies. So yeah, I think Alibaba doesn't have to force its way ahead. It's just gonna follow the trends that are propelling China into the world. And they have to be careful. They've hired Michael Evans, who's the former vice chair of Goldman Sachs. He's the president and he's based here in San Mateo. So they have people in Washington to deal with government lobbying. So they're being careful, you know, but they're expanding rapidly.
So I was in Shanghai early this year, so I was pretty impressed on how the technology has become in China.
Yep.
So Google has kind of left the Chinese market.
Yeah.
And do you think we still have a chance to go back in? And if there is, what should our strategy be to get back to China?
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess for now, I'll just see how Zuckerberg gets on with Facebook. Because, you know, he's learned Chinese. I would like to joke that Jack's English is a lot better than Mark Zuckerberg's Chinese. But actually, you know, Jack was an English teacher and Zuckerberg is learning and making a big effort. So I think right now everybody's focusing on, can Facebook really find a way in? I'm doubtful, frankly, because the moment you try to kind of dilute the China service, then it kind of dilutes the whole network in a way. But he's determined to give it a try. And he's, you know, he's there often and he's meeting the officials. And so I think for Google, I mean, there's obviously, you know, there was a history there, and it was actually a very sad time, I think, when Google left China. Not just me saying it, but I think a lot of Chinese found it depressing that you know, Google felt it had no choice but to leave. At least some people said they had no choice but to leave. Of course, Google is still there in terms of, I think you're selling, you know, people need to interface with Google, Android, all this stuff. So, but the question is to become a real player within China. Yeah, it's going to be tricky given. Particularly recently, the more strict content management and so on. And it's actually getting even more strict every month. I mean, we're seeing now, you know, ban on sort of foreign content providers from having partners in China. And in China, you never know. Like, the rules say you can't do something, but, you know, you couldn't survive if you followed all the rules. You know? So we're all trying to parse and see whether these rules are really going to be forcing out more content providers. But China should ultimately be confident in itself, right? I mean, look at the scale of Alibaba, Tencent, Baidu, these companies. It's not like if you were to open the firewall tomorrow, they'd collapse, right? But I think, yeah, that'll be a sign of China's confidence when they allow people to come back in and expand. And I look forward to that day when Google is able to do more. But I'm not holding my breath. I've been in China for 20 years waiting for the Chinese telecom market to open up. That's why I went there. So I learned to kind of switch my goals. Otherwise, you get a bit frustrated.
One more question.
Oh, of course, yeah.
So, in terms of investing in long term, so
yeah,
not doing, let's say, investments into riskier, you know, like funds, but, you know, like more conservative investing into, you know, like a broader economy in China. Mm-hmm. How much risk do you see because of the unresolved trajectory of China in the long term?
In terms of the economy, or
No, the political trajectory.
Well, that's just
because I mean, you know, like there's obviously systemic risk, right? I mean, you know, like for any long-term investment.
Well, I mean, partly, I mean, a lot of people are speculating now. There's so much Chinese investment. You know, maybe those of you who are fortunate enough to own property are seeing big appreciations in the Silicon Valley, partly because of that very question. I mean, yes, Chinese are investing also because they want their kids to go overseas, but there's also a hedging your bets attitude right now. We've seen capital flight. Quite significant capital flight, which is beginning to attenuate. But so yeah, I mean, like any self-respecting entrepreneur in China has to kind of hedge their bets. And international might be a useful expansion, maybe for some technology, maybe for some diversification. But ultimately, domestically, there's no choice. They have to work the system somehow. They have to try and help the government move in the right direction. So, you know, Li Keqiang sometimes seems like quoting verbatim the stuff that Alibaba and others are saying about Internet Plus. You know, like, how can the internet help us with O2O and other things? China has huge headaches. And the idea, the faith that Jack has in the internet to solve these problems is kind of infectious. I mean, he's always had this almost religious zeal about the internet. And I think the government's kind of buying into that now. I mean, yes, it's also been a source of their own headaches, the government with content and things like that. But they also know they can't just keep churning out the old stuff and trying to export it. So we're approaching a crossroads. We always are. But this one is real, because they can't keep recapitalizing the banks. They can't keep bailing out these state-owned enterprises.
That's exactly what I was after.
Yeah, and actually, the government right now, people are concerned. I mean, if you talk to the foreign business community, they're concerned. There isn't this zeal for reforming. We've had this very strong anti-corruption drive. And you know, so the fact that Jack has to be very nimble, he has to be quick, to coin another phrase. You know, and but he's shown himself. I mean, the last line of the book, to give away the spoiler, is people think of Alibaba as a story. It's a strategy. I mean, he's a master strategist, and he studied, you know, traditional Chinese martial arts and Forrest Gump, but whatever. He has his own little worldview, but he's applying that to this level of risk. But yeah, so chapter 12 is the last chapter. I'm interested in chapter 13, 14, 15. Watch the space. Maybe that'll be the movie. So. Great.
All right.
Thank
I think we should thank Duncan.
Oh,
thank you for coming to Google.
Thanks, Boris. Thank you.